The question was, what can we do now? They were queuing up outside our embassy and outside the Swiss and outside the other neutral embassies, pleading for help. And what could we do? Well, very hard. There was nothing in our book of instructions who told us what how we could save people of other nationalities. We are representing Sweden. We are helping Swedish citizens and all that with the working for the relationship between Sweden and that country where we are stationed, all that. But to take a whole group of other nationals under our protection, in a, how could we do that? But that's the time when I came to think of the only way we can do this is to give, and we got authorization from Sweden. There were so many relatives, Jewish relatives in Stockholm and all that, who were pushing the Foreign Office to do something and all that. So we suggested that those who have relations with Sweden, relatives or commercial relations, we could give them a visa to Sweden. Well, visa, they couldn't travel, of course. They couldn't travel through Germany. So what could you do? Well, I invented then a kind of a certificate where I said that the holder of this paper has got a visa to Sweden. Until he will be able to travel to Sweden, he will be under the protection of the Swedish government, with stamps and things on that, that you see. A completely illegal document. But the Nazis, especially the Hungarian Nazis, who already at that time had come up to surface like that, there were many of them were illiterate and they were impressed by stamps and things. So we saved a couple of hundred people in doing this and issuing these papers. But we couldn't cope with the ever increasing number of applicants. So we sent for help from Sweden. Same cruel method, but in another way. And that was when I was with Raoul Wallenberg now and then at the so-called death marches from Budapest to Hegyeshalom, that is the border city between Austria and Hungary. And that was towards the end of the war when the transport line, the trail, the trains didn't function any longer. Everything was bombed and so on. So in their desperation then to get the people deported, the Nazis, that was the Hungarian Nazis who were active then at that time. They had taken over, you know, towards, as I told you, after the 15th of October. They pushed the people, they took the people as they were, standing in their ordinary clothes, perhaps in the streets or whatever, just took them out from houses and pushed them to march these 200 kilometers in the snow. It took a week, that march, to the border, where then they were taken over by the German Eichmann Commando and sent to Auschwitz. But that was a very barbaric way of doing it, because they had to spend the night in open air in the cold, and there were corpses all around, and they were dying during the way, during the march, and all that. And what we could do was very little. We tried to distribute food and all that as much as we could, which was forbidden, of course. And Wallenberg managed at the border town there to save a few people also now and then. There are many of these episodes which where I was a witness.
Did you went there by car?
Oh, yes.
Was it only one car or many cars?
Well, we had one car together, and then we had trucks. When Rallenberg managed to, he bribed them, these Nazi people there and so on. So now and then we managed to get people back. It would be that you should never forget what happened during that time, that terrible time. Because if you forget it, or if you don't learn about it, it's a the risk will be greater that bigger that you it will be repeated again. So the way is here to first of all to spread the knowledge about what happened this Holocaust situation. It should be documented in all kinds of ways by films and books and so on, interviews like this. And then you should also remember the deeds of Raoul Wallenberg, because that in a way gives hope that there is, as long as there is a Raoul Wallenberg, there could be another Raoul Wallenberg again. Let's hope for that, and if it would come to the worst again. I mean, as long as a Raoul Wallenberg has existed, done what he did, I think that gives hope.
Finally, I can say thank you on the film, on the television. Mm-hmm. I wanted to thank you so many times, and now I have the possibility to thank you and the Swedish rescue mission and the Swedish legation and attaché anger, as my mother always quoted to say, attaché anger. I had a meeting with attaché anger. So I wanted to thank you because you were working on a protective passport for us, and we have been able to survive. Thank you for you. Thank you for our. Thank you for the whole Swedish mission who saved our life. And as a symbol, I wanted to thank you that you stayed behind, in spite of the fact that you could have been killed any moment. And I know from your wife, you sent her back with your newborn baby in October 44, because Birgitta was born in May or June 44, with a newborn baby. And your wife didn't know where you are, how you are, whether you survived, you are in life. And I remember that especially the Hungarian Nazis, they didn't care sometimes. They just killed anyone whom they didn't like. So that you risked your life every time you went out to save people. And also when you have given all this protective document to 1,000 people whom I believe that if they would have the possibility to come to you today, they would be more than happy and to thank you what you have done. Especially now that we know what have happened, that we could survive, I thank you very much.
Thank you. Could you thank please you. Tell me your name?
My name is, in Hungarian, I was born Kati Kadelburger, and now my name is Kate Watts, as married.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm.